Looking for filters? Check your coffee maker. This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott. FilterFreeRadio.com. Get ready to suck down some grounds.
A six-year investigation into cancer rates at one of the country's largest coal loading terminals has found workers there are getting cancer at nearly three times the national average.
Workers are developing a mix of cancers, melanoma, prostate and colorectal.
Is it something that's in the water, is it something that's in the air? You know, those are the questions that we need answered.
Live every Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern, Filter Free Radio.
These are sacrifice zones, areas that have been destroyed, environmentally destroyed, communities destroyed, human beings destroyed, families destroyed, for quarterly profit.
What the researchers have found has sent ripples of fear through the coal terminal company's workforce.
There's a 1.7-fold increase in the risk of cancer compared to state and national average, and a 2.8-fold increase in the risk of cancer compared to the local comparison population.
These projects are proposed and funded by Goldman Sachs, Peabody Coal, Arch Coal, and Berkshire Hathaway, who will profit immensely.
Because there are no impediments left, these sacrifice zones are just going to spread out.
You call them sacrifice zones.
Right.
Explain what you mean by that.
The individuals who live within those areas have no power. The political system is bought off, the judicial system is bought off, the law enforcement system serves the interests of power. They have been rendered powerless. You see that in the coal fields of southern West Virginia.
Your number one source for unfiltered truth, analysis, and solutions. FilterFreeRadio.com.
You are rendering the area moonscape. It becomes uninhabitable. It's all destroyed and it's not coming back.
I live in the Columbia Gorge and I love it. It's a vital, healthy community.
Mike Beebe is my name. I'm born and raised here in Longview. I'm very proud of this town and I'd sure like to see it, you know, taken care of for my grandchildren as well as their children.
I'm a member of Whatcom Docs. We're a group of 160 local doctors and we're all opposed to the proposal to ship coal through this community.
I'm the mayor of the city of Bellingham. We're a city of about 80,000 people, and we're about 10 to 15 miles south of the largest coal export facility planned for North America.
Right now we're looking at several proposals to build coal export facilities
that would start with strip mining in Wyoming and Montana,
mostly from the Powder River Basin.
Ship it 800 miles down the Columbia River through all our backyards.
To be loaded onto cargo level ships and shipped
to Asia, mostly China and India.
And there's so many compelling things against this terminal.
These projects are proposed and funded by Goldman Sachs, Peabody Coal, Arch Coal, and Berkshire Hathaway, who will profit immensely. Together, they propose to export over 100 million tons of coal each year, 10 times what Oregon and Washington currently burn.
These trains are almost a mile and a half long.
Each train car will lose 1 pound of coal dust per car per mile.
If we had a coal terminal 3 miles away, all of us would be covered with coal dust.
You know, the bottom line is that pollutants in the air that we breathe are responsible for lung disease. So asthma, emphysema, pulmonary fibrosis, pulmonary malignancies, and those are concerning to us as local physicians.
Our rail crossings through town are going to be closed for 10 minutes out of every hour, 365 days a year. That means
commerce will be stopped.
Emergency vehicle delays at rail crossings, increased potential for train-related fatalities.
Personally, I know people that have told me that they're not going to sit in line watching coal trains go by for 45 minutes to shop in Longview.
The coal company really comes at the cost of all these other industries, all these other jobs.
That if you go the direction of the coal, then what clean business is going to come to Longview?
There's something inherently dirty about coal power plants spewing out black smoke. Coal is a 19th century power source, and coal is the worst contributor to climate change.
If we say yes to this, we're letting our children live in a far more filthy world than what we've lived in. And that is not a legacy to leave behind. It's not something to be proud of.
We've come to a point in the road where we can go back to the 19th century or move ahead. There's new proposals popping up all the time. But with your help, we can win this fight. share this video with your friends and visit powerpastcoal.org to sign a petition opposing coal export. Thanks for your help.
And welcome to Filter Free Radio, broadcasting live from Portland, Oregon and Washington, D.C. Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott here with you. That introductory video comes to us from ColumbiaRiverKeeper.com, and that's what we're talking about today on Filter Free Radio, proudly broadcasting live on FilterFreeRadio.com. The home of Nicole Sandler, RadioOrNot.com. Also, ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. So good to be with you. And Skeptical Scott, ladies and gentlemen, is in the house from D.C.
Hello.
Scott, good to have you with us, buddy.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Hope all is well. Well, Scott and I are going to be talking about everything that you can find right now on the Filter Free Radio Facebook website, facebook.com/filterfreeradio. I want to get right to it. Earlier yesterday, I had the privilege of speaking with a very important guest who is going to tell us about a very important demonstration coming up here in Portland, Oregon, this Saturday, August 18th. Everyone in the greater Pacific Northwest, reaching, calling all Oregonians, all Washingtonians, anyone on the Columbia River and the Columbia River Gorge, anyone between the states of Montana and Wyoming and the West Coast, this show is for you. No one else. Well, and if you are so compelled by this to get active wherever you are, we have a lot of information coming up on how you can help out what's going on right now on the West Coast as far as coal exporting is concerned. There is a new proposal, a proposal for six new transportation routes, trains and barges to extract coal out of the United States of America in the states of, as I mentioned, Montana and Wyoming. They are going to extract this coal and ship it across the United States to the West Coast through my backyard in Southeast Portland. Attention, neighbors and friends, this is why we need to talk about this. And eventually hit the coast of Oregon, hit the coast of Washington State, export it to foreign countries overseas, to China, to India, etc. They are going to burn it, and we are going to suffer from the emissions. This is a problem. We need to talk about this, and no one's talking about this as far as I can tell. I had the pleasure of interviewing Bonnie Meltzer. She is the co-founder of a local, here in Portland, grassroots activism no coal group, and she is organizing a protest this Saturday here in Portland, and this is the first part of the interview with Bonnie. It is an honor to have with me on the line Bonnie Meltzer. She is a co-founder of the North Portland Coal Committee, a completely independent grassroots activism group, which is getting ready to have a no coal demonstration this Saturday, August 18th, here in Portland, Oregon. Also, check out the website Good Growth Northwest, the website goodgrowthnw.org, for more information on that. Bonnie, welcome to Filter Free Radio.
Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure to speak with you. Can you, for the listeners who might not know what's going on with the West Coast coal export issue and proposals going on, we've got a big deal on our hands. Can you tell our listeners kind of what's going on here, Bonnie?
Coal didn't come through the Northwest, and it doesn't at the moment except for one train. But there's a lot of coal in Wyoming and Montana, which mostly goes east. There's a movement to stop using coal, which is so poisonous. And a lot of companies, a lot of electric companies, are transferring from coal to another source. But ha-ha, China, India, and other parts in Asia would really like to use this coal. So companies are buying up that coal and want to transport it to Asia. Ah, how do you get to Asia? Coal is heavy. Coal is dirty. Train is a very efficient way to transport things. So they want to put the coal onto trains and then bring it to port. However, there aren't any ports in Washington to be able to...
Oregon and Washington State, I'm sorry.
...to be able to transport this coal.
Sure.
Have to build six ports.
Six.
Three in Oregon and three in Washington.
Six ports.
Six. And they would like to have all of them, and there's six different projects with six different rules, because there are different train companies involved, and there's also barges that are involved. So Oregon and Washington would just be a pass-through for this coal. And you might say to yourself, so what? Well, here's the so what. Coal is dirty. Coal can spontaneously combust if it's in covered containers. There are some kinds of covered containers which could ameliorate this issue. However, it's very expensive and there's still issues with it. There's also coal loss at 1 pound per mile per coal car. And you still say, so what? How much could that be? Well, there are 125-ish. Maybe it's 120, maybe it's 150, depending on which particular route and at which particular time.
Sure.
That's a lot of coal that is lost in our soil, in our water, and in our air. And now let's look at it. It's not just one train a day. It's many a day.
Many trains. Many trains.
In Portland, this is not passing through Portland, kind of on the outskirts, and forgetting about not affecting neighborhoods, but
right.
It's coming through neighborhoods where people live, where people work, where people shop. In North Portland, 8 trains will come through a day. Now, that's full train, but all these trains have to come back and be refilled. So then there's another 8 trains. Our sisters in Vancouver, Washington, which really is the closest neighborhood to me, there's just a river between us. It's another state. And they
right.
have
the Columbia River separates Oregon and Washington.
They will have a whole different set of rules. 26 full trains a day.
Wow.
Say that again. 26. Plus, they will have 26 empty trains. And you might still say, well, the empty trains can't be that much trouble. But there's a lot of noise in these coal trains. If anybody lives within 2 miles or 3 miles of a train, you can hear them tooting. I can hear them tooting all night long. Sound is disturbing, and actually there's some evidence that sound, big sound like that, changes people's blood pressure and creates more heart problems and also disrupts sleep, which has a host of other problems.
That's why you see whenever you're in a hospital or a doctor's office, you always see nice, pretty nature scene pictures and nice, soothing nature sounds because, you know...
You don't have pictures of coal cars.
natural environment surroundings and habitat are very common and very right. relaxing and very therapeutical to humans and all of the other species and
right.
whatnot that share it.
So it's the noise. Now these are a mile and a half long. So if you live or have to work on the other side of where the train tracks are, where there is a grade crossing, at a grade crossing where the train and the street meet.
Right.
And I'm sure everybody, if you live in Southeast Portland, you know that when that train comes on 11th and 12th almost by division, you have to wait. But now let's say you're late for work and that coal car comes along and it's 10 minutes long. And not only that, you are sitting there in harm's way. You are sitting there where coal dust is going to fall on you.
And as you mentioned, Bonnie, so kind of to sum up for our folks who are just kind of becoming aware of this issue, you have a gigantic kind of coal proposal operation that would extract coal out of the states of Wyoming and Montana, ship it via barge and trains all the way out to the West Coast, completely damaging the environment, human beings, everything in its path on the way there, because coal is the dirtiest form of energy known. And the problem with coal is it's so abundant and it's so cheap and it's been used forever. When they started using coal in the 18th century, they did not realize the devastating effects of coal.
We know now.
Right.
We know now. And I have to say that there's two issues that I want to impress on people. I went to a party last night. And I talked coal to people, and they said, oh, yeah, we know about it. And then I said, did you know it's coming through your neighborhood? No. So I whip out my map and say, oh, you live in Southeast? Look. It's right here.
Yeah, let me mention for our folks, you have a really well-organized map on your website, goodgrowthnw.org, and also on the North Portland Coal Committee Facebook page. There's a brilliant map of the Portland metropolitan area, including Vancouver, St. John's, Troutdale, downtown Portland, Milwaukee, the airport. And you see all of these six different proposed lines that completely dissect and go through the entire Portland metro area, not to mention all the way from Montana and Wyoming to the West Coast for export overseas. The entire Portland, and I live in Southeast Portland. That's where I'm speaking to you from right now. This is a big deal. And I've been talking with a couple of my friends and neighbors. Some of the folks here don't even know this is going on.
Most don't, and the press. There are a few very good articles in the Oregonian.
Yeah, folks really need to check out both of our Facebook pages where we've posted a lot of great information about this. Facebook.com/North Portland Coal Committee. And Facebook.com/FilterFreeRadio.
But the press stuff, they talk about the big issues, they talk about the ports, they talk about the few jobs that might happen, they talk about the degradation, but you know, unless it comes home to most people who are really busy, and you can say, if your kid is going to be outside playing with a mask on,
yeah,
because you don't want your kid to breathe it, there are apartments that go right up to the cut. And actually, some of your listeners in Portland have gone on the Peninsula Crossing Trail, which is a trail bought by Metro Regional Government. They've been buying up land to make beautiful paths so people can use their bicycles for both transportation and for pleasure. And they bought up land. They bought it from the railroad company, which is right adjacent to the St. John Cut, where six full trains and six empty trains will go. Well, I walk this path with my husband. I walk it with my girlfriend. Nobody's gonna want to walk there. And Metro spent a lot of money. They put a nice path so bicycle riders don't, you know, have to go on a bad path. It's actually been paved. It's very comfortable. It's great for old people. We see a lot of people with their families, with little kids with tricycles. They're not going to want to have 10 minutes of horrific noise, coal dust, and pollution. There's also the pollution from the diesel. And diesel's more insidious because it goes further. It goes, that diesel fumes can go 30 miles. We know from when the mountain blew in 1981.
Mount St. Helens.
Volcano dust traveled around the world, and people were getting that dust from everywhere. We also know, very recently, a big, heavy dock came across the Pacific Ocean, which is pretty big, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, a little...
And it landed in Oregon.
Fukushima tsunami debris.
That's right, because there are westerly winds. I'm sure all your viewers have heard of westerly winds. So this is a gift that will come on giving. It will ruin the Pacific Northwest.
Well, yeah, and I think that's the point you're getting to there is it's a lose-lose any way you look at it. The point here is the coal is exported overseas to China, India, etc., and they are the ones reaping the benefits of our extracting our natural resources in this country. It's being exported overseas, burned, and put into the atmosphere, and we get the devastating health and climate change effects of this garbage. If you're just joining us, we're speaking with Bonnie Meltzer. She's a co-founder of the North Portland Coal Committee. Let me strongly suggest you check out their Facebook page, facebook.com/North Portland Coal Committee. Also, check out the website, goodgrowthnw.org, Good Growth Northwest, goodgrowthnw.org is the website. Bonnie, there is a demonstration protest coming up this Saturday, August 18th, and we're trying to get a lot of folks out there to help express their frustrations, their concerns, their opposition to this. Tell me about this demonstration coming up Saturday that you're helping organize.
Okay, Richard Elmeyer and I and our neighbors have planned this protest mostly as an informational event and to let people know that this is happening. We have, under the guidance of Barbara Ellis, have knocked on 1,100 doors, and most people did not know. And these were 1,100 doors right on the cut.
Wow.
Right there on the cut. And it is horrifying to me that they didn't know. And I think I've mentioned this before, that people just don't know, or they think, oh, well, they couldn't bring these. They're trying to be reasonable. They say they couldn't bring these into our neighborhood. So we want people to come. If you want to wear coal black, you are welcome to. If you want to wear a costume, a friend of mine who's a puppeteer is bringing a beaver puppet. You can make signs. Your signs could say whatever you want them to say. We're also making some no coal signs and stop coal signs. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to start at the railroad cut by the Peninsula Fred Meyers and Peninsula Crossing Trail on Lombard Street, North Lombard Street, halfway between I-5 and the St. John's Bridge on Lombard.
Right, and for our folks on the West Coast who might be trying to come down from Seattle or other outlying areas, this is off of Interstate 5, I-5 in North Portland.
Right, so if you want to, you can take the train, the yellow line, get off at Interstate and then hop on a bus going westbound towards St. John's. It's about 2 miles.
It's going to be right near the Fred Meyers on North Ida and North Gilbert, North Lombard Street. They're at the St. John's Railroad cut.
This is not a big plaza. This is a street. And so we will be on the street and we're going to be kind of single file. We're not going to move. We're not going to march. But as people come, they're going to move east of the cut. And we would like that to be a nice long ribbon that goes from the railroad cut, where there'll be 12 trains a day, 6 full, toward the railroad tunnel, which is all less than a mile away. And I don't think we'll have enough people. I mean, I would love it if we had enough people to go across that whole mile. But we're going to move. We're going to try. We're going to move toward that direction. And people will stand, and there'll be a lot of traffic that day. Saturday is a busy day for North Lombard. We're going to have signs. You can make your own sign. We're going to have black balloons. We're going to ask people to blow them up themselves, but I'll have some ribbon for them that they can tie them up with.
Oh, then there's a really cool kind of theatrical demonstration idea behind, you know, if everyone comes to the protest dressed in black, we get these black balloons going, and we kind of show the folks around and demonstrate what coal dust actually does when it's on a train rolling through your neighborhood.
Right.
That's a really important element to this demonstration this Saturday. And the more people that we can get to come out to the protest, this demonstration on Saturday, the more people who dress in black and bring these black balloons, and we make this theatrical image and we create it, and it gets covered, the better chances it will be that we make it in the news locally here in Portland, up in Washington, Vancouver area, and surrounding areas. And maybe we need to get some national coverage on this. This is like the Keystone XL pipeline of the West Coast, only it's worse. It's coal.
We want to alert the press, too. And if we're just a bunch of boring people standing there, first of all, nobody will know what we're doing. It's very important to have signs that let people who are going past say, why are they saying no coal? One of my friends actually made this wonderful sign that said, I'd rather be breathing, and she borrowed my little mask, and she wears, I don't know if she's too hot on next Saturday.
All are
really
welcome.
Important, you know, if you want to wear a costume, wear a costume. That is how you get noticed, and you're right. There is a theatrical element, but I also want to show our leaders, and there will be some leaders here. We want our leaders to come. Jefferson Smith will be there because he's very anti-coal coming through our town. I believe Charlie Hales is going to be there. They're running against each other. This is the hottest issue that is, no pun intended, that is going to hit Portland.
I'm curious as to, maybe to the folks who are listening, any suggestions on what they may be able to do or what more can be done to stop coal? Call and write your local officials. Any thoughts on that?
Yes, write the president.
Yeah, President Obama, they have a campaign ad out right now that's basically pro-coal. Here locally in the Northwest in Oregon State, Washington State, I know Oregon Senator Jeff Merkley, Democrat, would be a good person to express your concerns to.
Put out a statement. It's not particularly strong, but at least it's in the right direction. There's a big meeting that being put together at Wyden's office.
Senator Ron Wyden of Oregon.
Yes, I was at Senator Merkley's office. Actually, Richard and I were the presenters. North Portland Coal Committee were the presenters at that, which was also a credo event.
Uh-huh.
But everybody has to get involved.
Yes.
From Metro, from your city government. The city of Vancouver is way ahead of Portland. Theirs is very much more dire straits.
Yeah.
But when I went to an art event in Vancouver, everybody I talked to knew about it, because when the city council said, we are putting a no coal proposition together, then people listen and the media listens, and so the news gets disseminated. That hasn't happened yet in Portland. I believe they're going to do something in September. And you have to go back and remember that these are six different ports with six different proposals. So those proposals are very scary in a way, because they're so convoluted. Who says yes to what? The Army Corps of Engineers, right to the Army Corps of Engineers. Go to Sierra Club, they have a whole list. Write to all your friends. Write to your relatives. Sorry, a plane.
Oh, hey, at least it's not a coal train, right?
No, it wasn't a coal train.
Well, it's actually a good time to take a quick break. Coming up here on the bottom of the hour, you are listening to Bonnie Meltzer, the co-founder of North Portland Coal Committee, here on Filter Free Radio, trying to get everyone in the Portland, Oregon area, Seattle, Washington, anyone on the Columbia River, to come out this Saturday, August 18th, in North Portland to the No Coal Demonstration. Find more information online at goodgrowthnw.org. Filter Free Radio, broadcasting live from Portland, Oregon and Washington, D.C. with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott and special guest Bonnie Meltzer. We'll be back in just a second on FilterFreeRadio.com, the home of Nicole Sandler, RadioOrNot.com, and ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. Don't go anywhere.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
RadioOrNot.com.
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 You're listening to Win
the Workers Independent News Service. I'm Jesse Russell. On July 28th, the biggest action to date against mountaintop removal mining took place at West Virginia's largest surface mine site, partially shutting it down. Opponents say the practice destroys mountains, buries streams, and damages the health of local residents, not to mention coal's role in climate change. Melinda Tuhus reports from Lincoln County, West Virginia.
Almost 50 protesters scrambled from a caravan of cars that dropped them at the lightly guarded Hobet 45 mine on Saturday morning. Organizers with ramps, Radical Action for Mountain People's Survival, kept the target secret even from other participants until they actually arrived at the site. 20 were arrested, while 24 were allowed to leave after heeding orders from police. Earlier in the day, at a rally in a nearby state forest, miners and their families faced off against another group of activists. Billy Epperhart held a sign that said, "Mess with a miner, deal with his wife," in an exchange that was part of a longer, mutually respectful dialogue with a local opponent of mountaintop removal. She said the ramp's website contributes to polarization.
It just breeds violence and anger.
And I think
I literally feel
communicate.
I feel like I'm fighting for my life.
Yes, I do too.
And my children.
I hear you.
So when I go to bed at night, that's what I go to sleep with.
In West Virginia, the coal industry still calls the shots, and miners, even non-unionized ones, can make $75,000 to $100,000 a year plus benefits. Meanwhile, the numbers the industry employs has dropped precipitously over the past 50 years. Dustin Steele, a young West Virginian who was an organizer with ramps and was one of those arrested, said that coal must be replaced as an energy source both because of its local impacts and its contribution to climate change.
Regardless of what we were doing or not, like, the market isn't going to support coal in central Appalachia for too much longer. And as that market continues to drop, and hopefully as we continue and become more steadfast and more efficient within our organizing, you'll see the dissenting voices of coal increase.
A growing number of studies have shown that residents of communities near mountaintop removal sites suffer higher rates of cancer and birth defects than those in similar communities further away, although an absolute link has not yet been established. An anti-mountaintop removal leader at the rally said the workers on those sites are at the same or greater risk as others who live near the sites, but a worker yelled back that he didn't need anyone to tell him what was good or bad for him or his family. Melinda Tuhus, Workers Independent News, Lincoln County, West Virginia.
This report was made possible in part by a grant from the Burger Marx Foundation.
You've been listening to WIN, the Workers Independent News. For more information, visit laborradio.org.
Unfiltered truth, news, and opinion. Filter-free radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
How do you impart upon somebody the disconnect or what's otherwise known as hypocrisy that people have, that they deny themselves from? You know, they live in denial and live in the illusion.
You can't tell somebody they're wrong. They have to see it themselves.
Yeah, they have to discover for themselves how to think that way. So how do you plant the inception?
Filter-free radio, Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern. Radio or not, and filterfreeradio.com.
Never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to The Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com.
Bill Maher, you're here in Miami on Friday night. You're doing a show at the Fillmore at the Jackie Gleason Theater. They just renamed this theater the Fillmore.
Oh.
And they put up a couple of psychedelic posters. So I guess...
Is it the theater Jackie did his TV show for?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
What I hear they did is put up two of those old Bill Graham posters and renamed it.
Yeah, I can't think of two different icons of show business.
Yeah, really.
Bill Graham and Jackie Gleason.
Yeah, why they just didn't play up the Jackie Gleason aspect, I don't know. But then again, this is South Florida.
Right. Okay.
Welcome to it.
I feel warm.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, or podcast anytime at radioornot.com.
FilterFreeRadio.com, your number one source for undiluted truth, analysis, and solutions. Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott. It's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it.
Now if I tell you that you suffer from delusion, you pay your analyst to reach the same conclusion. You live your life like a canary in a coal mine. You get so dizzy. We'll be right back.
And welcome back to filter-free radio broadcasting from Portland, Oregon, and Washington, D.C. Jacob Dean, Skeptical Scott, and our special guest, Bonnie Meltzer, the co-founder of the North Portland Coal Committee, are with you. And we're talking about a no-coal demonstration coming up this Saturday here in Portland. Everyone in the Great Northwest area is encouraged to come down this Saturday, August 18th, from noon to 3 p.m. The site of the protest is near the Fred Meyers on North Ida and North Lombard Street. It will be at the St. John's Railroad Cut at North Lombard in Portland, in North Portland. The easiest way to get to it would be from I-5, Interstate 5. And anyone, especially on the Columbia River, in the Columbia River Gorge, if you happen to be in the Troutdale, Gresham area, you are affected as well. Folks down in Milwaukee, you are affected as well. Out near St. John's, anywhere, all the way out to Coos Bay, and out to Longview in Washington State, everyone in between, you are affected. These trains are going to be coming through your backyard, and we need you this Saturday to come on down to the protest. Check out Good Growth Northwest for more information. GoodGrowthNW.org. GoodGrowthNW.org. Also, great information available on the Facebook page, facebook.com/North Portland Coal Committee. And facebook.com/filterfreeradio. We posted tons of articles that we'll be talking about here later coming up in the program. For our listeners who might have missed this earlier in the conversation, kind of the environmental impact here and how, you know, we've got this demonstration coming up this Saturday. Maybe folks outside of the Great Northwest or up in Seattle or down in California want to come participate. How can people really get involved and make a difference here if they want to stop this coal from exporting overseas out of this country?
The environmental damage. Our governor, and please write to our governor and keep him pushing him. He's doing a great job. He has asked for not a port impact statement, which is at the six ports or the three ports that are in Oregon, but he has asked for a region-wide port, and he's also asked for a national policy on this.
John Kitzhopper.
Right. We don't really have to study anymore. Maybe politicians have to cover their behind. But we don't have to study. We know that coal dust creates damage. The World Health Organization has said diesel fumes cause cancer. We already know some of that. We know how it affects response time when there's grade crossings that go through cities. Billings, Montana has been ruined because they've already had a million, and I'm using million as hyperbole here, coal trains coming through that. And they're slated to have more because all the ones that are going to come through here will come through there as well.
Yeah, we've covered on this program over the last month or so pretty extensively a new book that came out by Chris Hedges and Joe Sacco called Days of Destruction, Days of Revolt. And what they did was literally went around to these coal mining towns, pockets in West Virginia, et cetera, where these entire towns were based, the economy and everything was based around coal mining. And 50 years later, the town is a complete ghost town. All of the businesses and things are boarded up. Anyone who's left there is either sick or dying. And if you're out there, you know, in another part of the world or another part of the country hearing this and saying, you know, I really don't care about what's going on in Portland or in the Northwest or in Montana and Wyoming where they're going to be pulling this coal out, all I can say to you is this is a preventative measure. Once this is in place and these coal trains and these proposals are approved and built and operating, there is no reversal on the devastating effects on the environment, on ourselves as local residents of these communities, these neighborhoods who will be affected by this. I live a mile and a half away from one of these proposed train routes. It's scary. It's shocking to me to have conversations with my neighbors and friends who live here in this area. They don't even know this is going on, let alone they don't know what to do or how to get active or how to stop it. Start
we
by
shut down Trojan. That was the nuclear power plant. We did that. We voted on it. We did that. We pressured Boardman into not burning coal. It won't happen until, I think, 2020, but that's the path in the right direction. But if your listeners in the East Coast, you already have coal. That's where most of the coal from Powder River Basin is going. That's Powder River Basin in Montana and Wyoming. Because you have coal-fired plants. However, a lot of those coal-fired plants are being either retrofitted or changed in some way, and I can't really address that issue. But we already know what happened to West Virginia. The coal companies and the railroad companies, they have kept this secret for a long time, and it only started percolating out. There were a few articles in 2011, and I only became aware of it in April of 2012, and my husband and I looked at each other and went, okay, we got to do something about this.
Yeah.
So we've been mobilizing people and letting people know, and it's not a very formal group. We have no meetings. Now, we go to other people's meetings, and we go to neighborhood meetings, and we go to informational meetings, but we don't have meetings unless they're action. Like, we have a meeting tomorrow night with We Are St. John, and we're going to be making signs. Take action. Even if you do one thing, like sending an email, do it. Do the Facebook. Make comments. Tell your neighbors. Come to the demonstration. The more people we have, the more we'll be noticed. If you live anywhere along the Columbia River, please come. You will really be impacted in a very negative way. People in Longview, Clatskanie, and in Coos Bay, and in Grays Harbor, and in Bellingham, some of the people want the ports to be built because they think they're going to get a lot of jobs because they're hard hit. None of the bigger ports would say yes. Even PGE didn't say yes for land that they owned because they did not want that dirty air to come into their filters and gunk them up. Get active. That's all I can say. Do as much as you can.
Hallelujah.
But do something.
Amen. The no coal demonstration here in Portland this Saturday, August 18th from noon to 3 p.m. It's at the St. John's Railroad Cut Crossing at North Lombard Street near I-5.
It's about 2 miles from Interstate 5. It's halfway between Interstate 5 and the St. John's Bridge. You can get off at Interstate 5. Make sure you take the Lombard West exit and not the east, because then you'll go to the airport. The demonstration is at the St. John's Railroad Cut on Lombard by the Peninsula Fred Meyers, not the Interstate Fred Meyers, but the Peninsula Fred Meyers. You can get there by I-5, getting off at Lombard West and going 2 miles west on Lombard, and you will probably see us. We'll be there a little earlier. Go to the Facebook page. You can call me. You can write me. You can get a emailable. You can take things off. You can take the poster off of the website, the Facebook page, and send it to your friends. Come for as little or as much as you can. If you can stay for the whole 3 hours, that would be terrific. If any political people from anywhere are in town, please come. Talk to people. If you're running for office, say whatever your name is against coal, bring a sign. We want to make sure that our politicians don't get coal in their stockings and that we don't get coal everywhere.
Bonnie Meltzer, the co-founder of North Portland Coal Committee, the Facebook page, facebook.com/North Portland Coal Committee. Also check out the website, Good Growth Northwest, the website address, goodgrowthnw.org, goodgrowthnw.org. Bonnie, it's a pleasure, and thanks for coming on Filter Free Radio and all the great work you're doing out there.
Well, thank you for having me. It was really nice talking to you. That's a great question.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.
And Filter Free Radio coming to you live from Portland and Washington, D.C. Skeptical Scott, Jacob Dean here with you. I want to go thank you again to Bonnie for spending the better part of a half an hour conversation there with us about this important issue. We're going to continue talking about this throughout the rest of the program. Check out the Filter Free Radio Facebook page for links to all of the articles we're going to talk about in, coming up in just a couple of minutes, including the President Obama campaign ad that is basically pro-coal. We're talking about higher cancer rates that have come from a six-year study at a coal terminal in New South Wales. Workers at that coal terminal are getting cancer at strangely higher rates than everyone else. We're going to talk about the environmental impact of the coal. Also, why coal is the dirtiest form of power. There are local wildlife conservation groups here in the Oregon and Washington area calling for expanded reviews of these proposed coal lines. Also, local officials in the area, Representative Jim McDermott of Washington, Democrat, is working on this. Senator Jeff Merkley, Democrat of Oregon, is working on this. Also, the Oregon Governor John Kitzhaber. We're going to talk a little bit about all of that and more articles. Also, how come everyone isn't talking about the commercial fishing and sport fishing jobs that could be created with no need for coal? What about the solar and wind energy jobs that could be created that have nothing to do with dirty coal? All the other things that you are not hearing in other media, and why, oh, government environmental regulations, how come no one's calling them protection? A regulation is a consumer protection. These are environmental protections, and we like our nice clean air, our nice clean water, and our nice clean land, and we like to keep it that way because once crap like this happens, it is unreversible. This is called preventative longevity protection of the human race in the Great Pacific Northwest. Wake up, neighbors. Wake up, friends. Time to get active and do something about it. I interviewed my dad. I want to share this interview with you. It's only a few minutes long. My dad worked, Jdfishn in the chat room. JD, he's a big Radio or Not chat room contributor out there in the chat room. And if you are listening live, get into the chat room and participate live in the conversation in there. Jdfishn worked at the Port of Portland for 32, 33, 34 plus years, somewhere around there. And he had some interesting insights to share about the Port of Portland already built a facility to export coal over 30 years ago and, you know, didn't really work out as planned. Here's the interview. And it's my honor to welcome back to Filter Free Radio, Radio or Not chat room member Jdfishn. He's also my dad. Dad, you worked at the Port of Portland here in Portland, Oregon for a long time. And you are pretty familiar with the areas of these proposed coal trains coming through. You're pretty familiar with some of the environmental impacts that coal trains and coal emissions and these things can have on the environment coming through here. And also, I'm really curious to talk to you about back in the early 1980s, the Port of Portland built a coal terminal, or they built a terminal for the purposes of exporting coal, and that didn't work. That never came to be 30 years ago. I'm curious. Tell me about that.
Thanks for having me on. Did work at the port since the mid-70s. In the early 80s, I think it was 1982, 83, the Port of Portland, actually a contractor for the port at Terminal 5 next to the grain terminal out in Rivergate near Terminal 6, had a coal facility, exporting facility, via rail line coming in, built. They just about had it all completed. I know it was never finished due to the fact that they found out the demand wasn't that high in this region. And overseas at the time, the demand wasn't that high, and it just wasn't a feasible thing to do. Along with that, I believe they found out the environmental impact in the region, in the area. There were some concerns of coal exposure, dust coal, and along with that and everything, it just didn't fly for them. What they did eventually was, in that defunct coal terminal, is they retrofitted it and turned it into a bulk potash, potassium facility for exporting over to various Far East countries, which they in turn combined that with nitrates and potassiums and potash and phosphorus to make fertilizers for farming and what.
Sure.
But one thing I do know is they use unit trains currently that do come into the potash facility, which was the old coal facility, was going to be. And these unit trains are, you know, 80, 100 plus cars long. And I know folks don't care for that either. You know, if you get caught at an intersection where that unit train is coming through, you're going to be there a while. Because they go very slow coming into the terminals and going out.
And the the proposed coal trains that they're trying to bring through this area are potentially a mile and a half long.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, boy. So, you know, traffic alone was going to be interrupted along with the environmental impacts as far as exposures.
Sure.
You know, you've heard of the back in the days or even current days of, you know, some of the coal communities where they have the coal mines and all that, you know, the folks there, you know, just alone, you know, a lot of them refer to having the black lung.
The environmental devastation, the health
devastation
of the people who work there. You see, like I said, and those towns, for example, in West Virginia and other places around the country that were these complete communities that were built around coal mining and a coal mining facility are completely devastated now.
I'm sure a portion of them are. I know it's still a big livelihood for a lot of those communities and whatnot in these regions. But, you know, the long-term effects health-wise isn't good.
Yeah. I've got a cool picture up to, from the Oregonian back in the 80s. This is an old article about the Port of Portland coal facility that was built in the 80s.
Yes.
And the title, the headline of the article from the Oregonian back in the 80s was "Coal's Once Bright Future Goes Up in Smoke."
Ugh.
I thought that was kind of interesting. And, you know, it comes back to knowing your history so we're not doomed to repeat it, these kinds of things. You've worked for the Port of Portland for 30-plus years, really familiar with the areas around, for example, the Columbia River, the Willamette River, the Port of Portland terminals. This is, if you look at the map of the affected area of these proposed coal trains coming through, this is an area that you're pretty familiar with. This is also an area where you've put a lot of work into property maintenance, maintaining the environment, helping to keep the air and the water and the land and the soil clean, you know, as a concerned citizen, not necessarily as a Port of Portland former employee, but simply as a concerned citizen of this area who we live in Southeast Portland. We're literally right about a mile and a half away from the coal dust drift toxic emissions areas. A few miles away from that, it's pretty scary to have these really environmentally and health devastating proposed coal trains coming through your backyard. How do you, just kind of curious how you feel about that?
Concerns. Looking at the maps here, it looks like they're going to be using the rail lines on Washington, possibly Oregon, both come up the Columbia River Gorge. That pristine area there, it's a national historic site, and they're going to be bringing these unit trains, they could refer to them as, up the gorge into the Oregon and Washington areas for these trains. And it looks like the rail line is actually going to completely encircle the Portland metropolitan area and also in the Vancouver, Washington area and going up north to Longview and up into the Seattle area.
Yeah, this is just a picture I'll show you on the screen here, but these coal trains are coming from Montana and Wyoming all the way across the United States through our backyard, literally here in Portland, Troutdale, Vancouver, St. John's, Milwaukee, and it goes all the way out to the coast in Coos Bay, Oregon, up in Longview, Washington. There are six, they're proposing to build six new coal terminals in Washington and Oregon State to export coal that is extracted out of the Midwest and will be shipped overseas for export, eventually burned by foreign countries, and we get those emissions from...
Yes, that's understandable. Our environmental regulators here, as far as emissions, our standards are very high. Some of the other countries, say China, say in the Far East, whatnot, their environmental regulations aren't as strict as ours. So they are allowed to emit higher levels of pollutants into the air as far as emissions from their factories, from their industries. 30 plus years ago, it really wasn't as much of an issue as far as burning high pollutant power sources for industry as it is today, where, China has become one of the major industrial nations as far as industries. Their energy sources, they have to basically import a lot of that, which one is coal from us and other countries. Coal is a high-emitting pollutant.
Dirtiest form of energy.
One of the most dirtiest forms. And unfortunately, if you think about it, the atmospheric air prevailing winds come from the east. In the northwest region here, it comes from the east to the west. So their prevailing winds is our prevailing winds. And a lot of the pollutants from those air emissions over there come right back over here onto the west coast and inland.
Check out our website, filterfreeradio.com. A couple of weeks ago, we spoke with climate change scientist and author Bill McKibben. And one of the things Bill was talking about was, 20, 30 years ago, people didn't even know the harmful effects of burning coal and burning and carbon emissions into the atmosphere. And so now as there's more science and more research on these kinds of things, we know now more clearly what are some of the damaging effects. And I love that you talked about how we do have here, at least in the United States, some more stronger regulations as far as the environment. I want to mention, as far as messaging goes, regulations are simply consumer protections. Anyone who is harping on regulations, environmental regulations, those are protections. Regulations are protections.
EPA.
So if your conservative or Republican friends are out there, there's too many environmental regulations, too many environmental regulations, you need to turn around and say, I like my environment being protected. And here in locally, in Portland, in Oregon, in the Pacific Northwest, we even have even higher environmental protections in place that have been voted in by the people over the years, because we care about our environment, we care about our air, we care about our water, we care about our land. And I want to thank you again, Dad, Jdfishn from the chat room, for coming on and helping to share another story here and to grow the concern and awareness of this issue.
Yes, thank you very much. That you hit it right on the head there. We have real concerns of our environment here, and
human beings need a healthy environment to survive. I mean, whether you care about coal or the economy or the environment, whatever, maybe you care about your own life and existence. So yeah. That's important.
Well, that's it. Well, one has to weigh out the difference. The environmental impact of pollutants and is it a slow spiraling downward issue versus the profit of a few corporations that are profiting, from all this that's going to be happening. And we're basically selling our natural resources to another country that's turning around and going to pollute us right back again. I mean, if you stop and think about it, you got to weigh out the problems versus the benefits here. And people, it's time, going to have to start opening your eyes, start thinking about what's going on and realize the issues at hand.
And for folks in the Northwest, in the Portland area, calling all Oregonians, all Washingtonians, anyone in the Columbia River Gorge, get out this Saturday to the No Coal Protest. Jdfishn, thanks for coming on Filter Free Radio again.
Thanks for having me, guys. Take care.
Filter Free Radio, we are at the top of the hour here. When we come back, Scott and I will discuss all of the articles on the Filter Free Radio Facebook page. Make sure to get over there, check that out. And there's no more pre-recorded interviews to play for you. So that part of the program is over. But I was very fortunate to get to speak with Bonnie and my dad. Two really insightful opinions on the issue. And we're just trying to get anyone in Oregon, anyone in Washington, or the Pacific Northwest aware of what the heck is going on here. So maybe we can do something about it before it is irreversible, before it damages our environment and ourselves, before we don't have a choice. Filter Free Radio, filterfreeradio.com. We'll be right back with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
Giggity, 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 goo. Stick around.
tons of coal per year being strip mined in Wyoming and Montana and then coming through Oregon and Washington.
If it's approved, we're talking about as many as 50 coal trains, a mile and a half long, going through the Columbia River Gorge and through Multnomah County every day. It's going to turn the Columbia River Gorge National Scenic Area into the largest coal chute in the nation. For Oregons to promote dirty, toxic coal at a time that we herald ourselves as a leader in clean energy is just only going to give us a black eye.
We, Chinese people, need a clean air, clean water, no dirty U.S. coal.
Coal is crime. And I've been fighting the coal industry for 30 years. The coal that I've been fighting has been mainly in Appalachia. And I'm going to tell you what I've seen in Appalachia. Because the same thing that happened to Appalachia is what's going to happen here if you let coal into your community. Because wherever coal comes, it's toxic. And it's toxic not for just for adults. It's toxic for children, and it's toxic for our democracy, and it's toxic for all of the values that make America an exemplary nation. Coal is the enemy of our country, and it's the enemy of everything we stand for. So when coal says that it's cheap and it's clean, we know they're lying when they say they're clean, but they're also lying when they say they're cheap. If they really had to internalize their costs, if they had to pay the true cost that they are charging to the rest of us, they would be the most catastrophically expensive way to boil a pot of water that's ever been devised. They'll say, oh yeah, if you let us bring the coal through here, we'll bring you jobs and we'll bring you prosperity, and that's a lie. And that's what they've told for 100 years. They've told the people of West Virginia. Coal doesn't share its wealth. It keeps it for itself, and it makes a few people billionaires by impoverishing everybody else. It's going to start undermining everything that you love, everything that you value, including your children's health, and everything that makes you proud to be American. So you are on the front lines of this battle.
Hey, hey, hey. We're
going to the Steel Bridge, one of the proposed export routes that'll bring coal through Portland.
They're literally proposing to have uncovered coal trains causing catastrophic climate change coming through downtown Portland. We're sending a message from the Steel Bridge here today that our community won't let this happen.
Of Progressive Voices, weekday nights on Nicole Sandler's primetime lineup at RadioOrNot.com. Liberate yourself with Filter Free Radio, hosted by Jacob Dean every Monday night.
It's just the system is broken. Bring it down. Bring it all down, right?
On Wednesday nights, take a sharp progressive turn and join Talking Left with Danielle and Shano.
All those Republicans are anti-capitalist.
All of a sudden. Well, no, they're just anti-Romney.
Exactly.
and it's interesting to watch the three-legged stool splinter.
Then let it all hang out both Tuesday and Friday nights on Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick.
You love the Constitution so much, but you hate the government, but you love the corporations. Where does that come from?
Tune in to the primetime Radio or Not lineup weekday nights at the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, RadioOrNot.com.
I'm sorry, I just find the whole thing so ironic and so mind-bending, it's just ridiculous.
Hi, friends, this is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or Not.
Radio or Not.
RadioOrNot.com.
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 Looking for filters? Check your coffee maker. This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
FilterFreeRadio.com.
Get ready to suck down some grounds.
A six-year investigation into cancer rates at one of the country's largest coal-loading terminals has found workers there are getting cancer at nearly three times the national average.
Workers are developing a mix of cancers, melanoma, prostate and colorectal.
Is it something that's in the water? Is it something that's in the air? You know, those are the questions that we need answered.
live every Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern, Filter Free Radio.
These are sacrifice zones, areas that have been destroyed, environmentally destroyed, communities destroyed, human beings destroyed, families destroyed, for quarterly profit.
What the researchers have found has sent ripples of fear through the coal terminal company's workforce.
There's a 1.7-fold increase in the risk of cancer compared to state and national average, and a 2.8-fold increase in the risk of cancer compared to the local comparison population.
These projects are proposed and funded by Goldman Sachs, Peabody Coal, Arch Coal, and Berkshire Hathaway, who will profit immensely.
Because there are no impediments left, these sacrifice zones are just going to spread out.
You call them sacrifice zones.
Right.
Explain what you mean by that.
The individuals who live within those areas have no power. The political system is bought off, the judicial system is bought off, the law enforcement system serves the interests of power. They have been rendered powerless. You see that in the coal fields of southern West Virginia.
Your number one source for unfiltered truth, analysis, and solutions, filterfreeradio.com.
You are rendering the area moonscape. It becomes uninhabitable. It's all destroyed and it's not coming back.
Welcome back to Filter Free Radio. Jacob Dean broadcasting live from Portland, Oregon, where they are proposing to bring six different coal train routes extracting coal from Montana and Wyoming and bringing it through my backyard to ship it to China so I get to suck on the polluted air when it returns here. Bullshit. Welcome to Filter Free Radio. Skeptical Scott is with me live from Washington, D.C. Pardon my excessive bias towards this particular issue, but once it literally comes into your backyard, it's time to say, okay, time to do something about this. And the scary thing is, I've been talking to my friends, my family, people who live here, and they don't even know this is going on. Scott, what's up, brother?
Not too bad.
Yeah, hey. I haven't gotten a chance to hear from you much yet, so this is our hour to talk coal, talk pollution. We've got a whole bunch of stuff to talk about. Let me again suggest you check out our Facebook page, Filter Free Radio on Facebook, facebook.com/filterfreeradio. I posted probably 24 related articles, everything from the local conservation groups that are demanding further review of these proposals, to what the local officials are doing in Oregon and Washington State, to the maps of the affected areas. Anyone in Portland, Troutdale, Gresham, all the way out to Coos Bay, Longview, Vancouver, Washington, everywhere in between, down to Milwaukee. Jesus. Calling all Washingtonians, all Oregonians, alert. This is important.
I don't think it's just regional. I think the bigger picture here is that this, as is said before, is the equivalency of the Keystone XL pipeline, except for coal and not dirty tar sand oil, as if coal is clean somehow. And one of the striking things I heard from one of those videos was that the average coal car loses a pound of coal per mile per coal car.
Yes,
that seems hard to believe almost.
I'm happy that you mentioned that, Scott, because I have in front of me, we talked a lot about kind of the generics. I want to talk a little bit about the specific numbers of this. And, you know, if you want to talk about it on a national level, which we normally cover, we're a big picture show. And my apologies if so far this seems like a really minute focus here. But the big picture here, at least in the United States, is, and I will show the picture on the screen, the coal that's coming out of Montana and Wyoming is already exporting majorly through the eastern half of the United States. Look at that. The Midwest, the East, all of you folks, Adam and folks in Chicago,
wow.
Scott, you in D.C., in Virginia, in West Virginia, our good friend, Shane and Danielle used to be down in Florida. Nicole Sandler's down there in Florida. Texas. I mean, everywhere in the middle of that map, That's where the coal's already going. You see one line already going to Oregon, one line already going to Washington. We already have coal here. But they want to build six more in Oregon and Washington and run the lines through my backyard. I'll show that picture. This is a picture of the Portland metropolitan area. You see downtown Portland, the Portland airport. Vancouver, Washington is to the north. Milwaukee is to the south. To the east is Troutdale, Gresham. That's kind of where, you know, farther east, the Columbia Gorge. Those routes are going to come through up the gorge, in the river, along the river. Some are going to dissect Portland. I am right on the edge of, and the yellow highlighted area, that yellow area is the coal dust spread toxic emissions warning alert area. That's what that yellow kind of coloring around those highlighted train routes. I am literally talking to you right now from the edge of one of those yellow, right from the edge of the yellow line. And this is in my backyard right here. And I'm a little
freaked out. So if the Fukushima radiation doesn't kill you, the coal dust will?
You know, damn it. That's it, man. And so I'm a little pumped for this issue, as you can tell. When it affects you personally, it's a big deal.
Hey, man, but good on you, because, I mean, all resistance is local. I think the important thing is that you are getting active locally on local issues, and I think that's what's needed on a national scale. If everyone were to get active locally and address local issues, then we could all come together and coalesce around a national issue that is obviously a major part of the disease of these local symptoms, if you will. And so I think you're spot on, dude.
Oh, thank you, brother. I want to talk real quick, just for a couple of minutes, about the specific numbers of this proposal, the big coal coming through Portland, my backyard here. And also, I want to mention again, there is a no coal demonstration protest in Portland, Oregon, this Saturday, August 18th, 2012, in North Portland, near the Fred Meyers on North Ida and North Lombard Street. The actual site of the protest is the St. John's Railroad Cut there at North Lombard. If you're in the area, please come out this Saturday, August 18th, from noon to 3. Dress in black. It's going to be a really cool theatrical demonstration. We're going to film it, get some news coverage, build awareness, and hopefully the more folks know about it who I share backyards with, you know, we can create a opposition to this and maybe get John Kitzhopper, the governor of Oregon, to stop the three proposed sites, coal terminals that they want to build in Oregon, and all the tracks, the maps we've been showing you. Let's stop it before it happens, because it's kind of irreversible. The purpose of this demonstration really is to bring just public awareness and inform the folks. So even if you're not a protesting, you know, gung-ho, sign-holding, striking kind of person, it's just come out and we'll talk and we'll inform. And this is kind of a public awareness meeting, really. And we need folks to email, call, distribute, hang posters, write in newsletters, knock on doors, post on websites, post on Facebook, retweet this information to anyone you know in Oregon or Washington immediately. This is important. Everyone needs to take part and express their opinion, whether it is for or opposed. What?
Well, I got to tell you, I was going to say, I think my box was turned down there. I said,
Snikes. Yeah, it's just quiet.
It's just that drop. What I was going to say was that at the very least, it affects us all on a national level. And it just strikes me that I haven't heard about this sooner. I mean, this seems like something that's been going on for a long time here, and yet there's no national coverage of it whatsoever. And yet, you know, the Keystone XL pipeline gets a big deal when Bill McKibben surrounds the White House with, you know, 500 protesters or whatever. But I'm surprised even Bill McKibben hasn't talked about this. Like, this seems like a really big deal to me. And I'm not knocking Bill McKibben. I'm just, as an example, like, I would at least thought I would have heard this from him. If not, of course, not the mainstream media or corporate media. But it strikes me that I just don't know this. I mean, I guess the West Coast is really just in a different world than we are out here.
The proposal will bring every year, this is from the Powder River Coal Basin in Montana and Wyoming. They are proposing to bring 150 million tons of coal per year up the Columbia River to here where I am in Oregon, as well as, you know, through all those northern, southern states, et cetera, that come through that path. It's not a good thing. And not just the pollution and the environmental impact and the health impact. And like you heard in the intro we played at the beginning of the show and the top of the hour, that was from a news bulletin in the New South Wales about a six-year study at a coal terminal where all of a sudden all the workers are getting increased rates of cancer. Not sure where that's coming from. Maybe the coal terminal where they work at. But this is scary. And it's not just the environmental impact, but there's noise, as we talked with Jdfishn about. There's a traffic commuter problem with when you have mile and a half long trains coming through that move slow because they're carrying tons of coal. It's not just there, and the noise and that we were talking about with Bonnie. And of course, the carcinogenic diesel emissions and the toxic coal dust and just.
And then there's the fundamental question of why the hell are they doing this? I mean, we need to get the F off of coal and
right?
fossil fuels in general. And yet they're actually, to me, this what this says is that they have a surplus of coal and need to get it to market so they can sell it. And the next best market is shipping it overseas to China and India, where there's more of a demand than it is here, I guess it seems to me. Because that's how this works. I mean, there's a supply and demand. They obviously have a demand for this coal that's not being met here, and they want to outsource it or ship it overseas where there is a greater demand, which is striking because we have so much damn coal. Why are electrical prices so high, and why are we having all these, you know, electrical grid problems and so on and so forth? I mean, our infrastructure is just a joke, but
exactly,
you know, it strikes me as the expansion of a bad idea, you know,
yeah.
That at a time when we need new ideas,
yes,
and the recidivism, or I can't even think of the right word, and to stop coal in general, you know, the decommissioning of these coal fired plants and all this stuff. It's just remarkable, you know. It's literally like the XL pipeline.
Yeah, I love this picture. What do you call blocking 166 coal plants? A start. You're absolutely right, Scott, and you know, and that's why this is kind of a BFD here, but you know, kind of going back to the specific numbers real quick for my friends to the north in Vancouver, Washington, you're going to get hit the worst. There's a proposal. This proposal will bring 25 coal trains, which are a mile and a half long. They have 125 cars per train and 110 tons of coal per car. So that's 13,750 tons of coal per train, 25 trains per day. That's 3,125 coal cars per day coming through Vancouver, Washington, specifically 1,195 coal cars on the Bellingham route, 125 coal cars on the Grays Harbor route, 1,125 coal cars on the Longview route, 750 coal cars on the Port Westward route. All of that together.
Jeez. Are these all...
And this is the point here. There's six different routes. They want to build six different coal terminals with six different routes, three in Oregon, three in Washington, and all of them get this coal from in the middle of the United States, from Montana and Wyoming. They ship it over via barge on the Columbia River and coal trains up the Columbia Gorge right next to the Columbia River and out, and the Columbia River goes right into the Pacific Ocean on the coast of Oregon and export to China, India, etc., so they can burn the cheap coal because they don't have high emission standards or consumer protections in their countries. And eventually, that pollution is going to make it back its way back this way, as we've seen with the westerly weather flow and stuff like the Fukushima tsunami debris is washing ashore here in Oregon and Washington.
Well, everything's connected. I mean, it's important to remember that everything is connected. You know, I mean, the pollution from Fukushima is going to affect even me here on the East Coast in D.C. You know, which I mean, what am I, half a world away from Japan here?
Right.
You know, it's gonna affect us. I mean, it rolls as I believe Snark taught us. You know, this, I guess it's, I'm going to butcher this, but cesium or one of the other heavy metals rolls across the landscape, and it will eventually get here. And the same happened with when it melted down in Chernobyl.
Yeah.
You know, there's just, you know, there's going to be, people are going to die, and they're not going to be attributed to this coal train. I mean, you know, the deaths won't be attributed to this, just like the deaths from Fukushima on the West Coast won't be attributed to Fukushima. It'll just be overlooked, but there's no coincidence.
Yeah. Here in Portland, 8 coal trains per day, each train a mile and a half long. That's 150 coal cars per train, 1,000 coal cars per day coming through Portland, 855 pounds of coal dust, 858 pounds of coal dust deposit off of the trains a day in Portland. That's just the dust that you were talking about earlier. You know how each coal car loses on average between around a pound of coal per mile per car? That added up over the 1,000 coal cars per day traveling through Portland is 858 pounds of coal per day. Not good. you know, Multnomah County, Eugene, Port Morrow on the Columbia. Not good. What the heck can we do about it? That's kind of the point of filter-free radio, grassroots activism, bottom up, you know, people getting involved and doing something about it. Alert your friends and neighbors, share this information, send it, distribute it, publish this information. Anyone you know in Oregon, Washington, the Pacific Northwest, and, you know, how about West Virginia or anywhere on this map right here? If you know anyone that lives in this area, you might want to tell them that, hey, coal's not so good. And I get it. The problem is 50% of our country's energy, power, electricity comes from coal, because coal is so abundant and coal is so cheap, and coal has been used for a really long time. People, human beings have been burning coal since the 18th century. And when they started burning coal in 18th century, and they're like, wow, there's so much coal, and this is great, and we can get it easily, and it's a great energy source, they didn't frickin' realize that the carbon emissions and the toxic coal dust and everything associated with that process is bad. They didn't realize the devastating environmental effects, the devastating human health effects. And now that we know, now that we have the science, whether you choose to believe it or not as a matter of opinion based on your news source propaganda pusher, it doesn't matter. The facts are the facts. The truth is the truth. Whether you accept it or believe it or not, it is there. And it will kill us if we don't do something about it. So what can we do? Tell your friends. Spread the information around. People in Washington, Oregon State, prepare to recall port commissioners. Organize people who oppose these coal shipments through our community. Let's start the recall petitions for all the port commissioners in Washington and Oregon States. If and when any of them vote in favor of coal shipments, we will be ready to submit the recall petitions. Scare these people, scare the politicians, put fear into them, demand what we want as we the people. That's the only way it's going to happen. Scott, this is one of your favorite things, is if you make them scared or scared of us, then that's power, that's leverage. We dove into that when we read Saul Alinsky's Rules for Radicals. It's
yeah, man, fear works.
Just ask Fox News.
Yeah, why they use it.
I'm sorry. Can you not tell I'm pumped about this?
I feel you, dude. You know the one of the other things worth mentioning here too is that this is all this coal is coming from strip mines in Wyoming. And what was the adjacent state? Was it Idaho or
Montana?
Oh, Montana, yeah, Montana and Wyoming. And strip mining is something from the 16th century.
Right.
I mean, it's the same thing that they do, and they do mountaintop removal in West Virginia, which is a form of strip mining. But strip mining was abandoned for shaft mining, you know, drilling into the ground with a shaft and bringing out the coal that way in order to get, you know, deeper into the ground and get coal. And actually, to go back to 16th century technology to extract coal from the ground by just obliterating the landscape to get to the coal seam, you know, just below the surface or whatever, 400 feet down, however deep it may be.
Yeah.
But you're literally just wiping the entire landscape off just to, you know, lifting it up and removing it or whatever, and just to get to this coal seam. And it's just so devastating. I mean, God, Wyoming and Montana just must be a hellhole. You know, I mean, because let's face it, it's just like in West Virginia where they have this mountaintop removal mining. It's mostly the same thing. The pollution is just, it's unbelievable. I mean, it's just, it's literally a moonscape there. You look at it, you see pictures of it, it looks like a moonscape. There is nothing there. It's gray, and nothing will grow. And the water is poisoned. I mean, let's face it, you can't drink the water. You can't breathe the air. It's a copper smelting, you know, and that sort of thing. I mean, all these raw materials that they're just scraping out of the ground using arcane technology or, you know, from 400 years ago now. It's just, I mean, how far backwards do we have to go as a society before people say, all right, enough of this? I mean, why can't we all have solar panels on the roof of our houses and have our own independent energy and be done with this? Period. Huh. You know, it's and then charge your car, whatever it is you got to do for transportation. I mean, whatever. The point is that there's so many better options out there that are profitable. I mean, if you had to leave the capitalist model in place, there's a lot of money to be made with green energy and renewable energy and clean energy and whatever phrase you want to use, if it was to be pursued. However, the coal industry, the fossil fuel industry, will never allow it to happen because it would mean their extinction. And they don't want to transition into clean energy themselves because they have this whole system set up where they're going to make a ton of money exporting coal to China. I mean, you know, and the environment in the U.S. be damned because the money's coming from China and none of those people, you know, none of these executives live anywhere near any of these mines, be it in West Virginia or Wyoming. They live in their comfy homes in what, upstate New York or wherever else it may be, and they have no pollution in their backyard from this kind of crap. So it's, again, and I think the thing that was interesting too is that the video you played of Robert Kennedy Jr.
Yeah, that was that was a no coal protest in Portland just a couple of months ago. In Portland.
Yeah, so this has been known for, I mean, a while now, it sounds like.
Yeah, there's, and, you know, I've been living in Washington, D.C. for the last 2 years, so I've been removed from this area, and now that I've been back here for a couple of months, settled and getting aware and active again in the environment, or in the community, rather, you find, you know, things like, oh my goodness, there's 6 proposals to bring coal trains directly into my backyard. You know,
yeah, not in my backyard.
And here's the kicker. I haven't seen a single story about this on local TV in Portland, on any local news in Portland, on, you know, on the TV or on the radio. I've only found information online about this. So for what it's worth, you have to really find that truth-telling independent voice out there who's speaking the truth. Like Skeptical Scott and Jacob Dean on Filter Free Radio. When we come back, more discussion of this, more about what we can do to stop this and prevent this. And don't go anywhere. Filter Free Radio on RadioOrNot.com and ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. We'll be right back.
If I'm not back in 5 minutes, just wait longer.
Oh, and the automation machine crashes again. Stand by, stand by. Dun, dun, dun. Coming shortly. Stand by as we fix the computer.
Identify the problem. Fix it. Identify another problem. Fix it.
Thanks, Scott. Have you been waiting for a show that gives you the real news you need to know? Have you been waiting for a show that reports the truth and isn't afraid to call it as it is? I've been waiting for that show too, and it's not coming from the mainstream media. It's not coming from the bought and sold corporate media. It's not coming from the news networks that only look out for profits and their bottom lines. They all speak through filters. That's why you need filter-free news. That's why you need filter-free radio. Filter-free radio is your new news headquarters for exactly what's going on and just exactly what we need to do about it. We must move forward. Move forward with us. Filter-free radio, live Mondays 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern on the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com, and the all-new filterfreeradio.com.
Question. If you mix a cocktail of black liquor, biofuels, diesel, and a generous splash of tax subsidies, then have it shaken vigorously by Senator Mike Crapo and served in a golden goblet by corporate lobbyists, what do you call it? Answer, Koch Brothers Moonshine. Black liquor, a byproduct of the papermaking process, is an alcoholic sludge that paper mills use to fuel their operations. Fine. Creative, even. But then, the paper giants turn from creative to cabal, teaming with Senator Crapo and other practitioners of the legislative black arts to turn their sludge into a slick tax loophole. In 2007, Crapo and a covey of corporate lobbyists quietly made their liquor eligible for a subsidy meant to help wean America off of oil by encouraging the production of a biofuel gasoline mix to power cars and trucks. Not so fine. 1. Vehicles can't use mill sludge as a fuel. 2. Rather than mixing biofuel to their sludge, the paper makers add diesel. So these sneaks are siphoning off billions of dollars from a clean fuels program by making a dirty fuel dirtier. Who's profiting from this load of moonshine? Right at the top are the infamous far-right-wing Koch brothers. These multi-billionaire political extremists have been financing everything from corporate front groups to the Tea Party in a relentless effort to impose their plutocratic agenda on our country. One major way they pay for this onslaught is by tapping directly into the blatant corporate welfare of the black liquor loophole. The Koch industrial empire includes Georgia-Pacific, one of America's largest paper makers, and it's the happy recipient of up to $1 billion a year from the perverted biofuel subsidy. This is Jim Hightower saying, a dirty windfall from a dirty fuel to underwrite dirty politics. It all stinks.
Hightower's commentary is brought to you by the Hightower Lowdown. From Wall Street to Washington, this monthly newsletter reveals who's doing what to whom and why. Check it out, HightowerLowdown.org.
Are you living in a progressive talk void? If so, be sure to visit leftwingradiostations.com. The state-by-state listing is a quick and easy way to find any left-wing talk radio station across America. From sea to shining sea, your progressive talk nirvana is only a click away at leftwingradiostations.com. Be sure to like Left Wing Radio Stations on Facebook and share it with your friends. leftwingradiostations.com. United we stand.
Come experience the next generation of progressive voices. Weekday nights on Nicole Sandler's primetime lineup at radioornot.com. Liberate yourself with Filter Free Radio, hosted by Jacob Dean every Monday night.
It's just the system is broken. Bring it down. Bring it all down, right?
On Wednesday nights, take a sharp progressive turn and join Talking Left with Danielle and Shano.
All those Republicans are anti-capitalist.
All of a sudden. Well, no, they're just anti-Romney.
Exactly.
and it's interesting to watch the three-legged stool splinter.
Then let it all hang out both Tuesday and Friday nights on Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick.
You love the Constitution so much, but you hate the government, but you love the corporations. Where does that come from?
Tune in to the primetime Radio or Not lineup weekday nights at the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com.
I'm sorry, I just find the whole thing so ironic and so mind-bending, it's just ridiculous.
Hi, friends, this is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's radioornot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
Radioornot.com.
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 Radio or not.
Filter-free radio, unfiltered truth, news, and opinion. Filterfreeradio.com.
I was born one morning when the sun didn't shine. I picked up my shovel and I walked to the mine. I loaded 16 tons, a number 9 coal, and the star boss said, well, bless my soul, you load 16 tons. What do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store.
Welcome back to Filter Free Radio. That one for Skeptical Scott there in Washington, D.C. I'm Jacob Dean in Portland, Oregon, talking about coal and why it matters. Scott, it's always good to have you with me, buddy, and it's always a pleasure to have your insightful intellectual contributions to the program, as well as I also want to mention the contributions to the program from everyone out there in the chat room. I want to do a quick round of chat room shout-outs to Adam and myself, who happened to be in the chat room 3 times because I can't figure out how to use my computer. Also, Honey Bunny, Skeptical Scott, Snork Y2K, The Dark Ride. Welcome, Dark Ride. Thanks for checking us out. Vic and Will from Chicago. We've got a few other folks who are watching. They're not in the chat room. If you'd like to participate in the chat room, it's free. We don't ask anything other than a username and a password to log in. That's it. So check it out. And thanks. I haven't said anything. I just want to mention really cool that I have now in the back, as you can see, this is a replica. It's not an original. It's a reprint of an election poster for President Franklin D. Roosevelt. Vote Democratic, a gallant leader. Vote Democratic, President FDR. So there you go.
yeah, you can't really see it too well.
Yeah, I know you probably can't see it that well, but it's there. So for what it's worth. And Snork says the spelling looks right on that one, so that's good. I have in my hand an old patch that says conservation pledge on it, and I found this and it jumped out on me because it's got, you know, an eagle and some stars on it, conservation pledge, and I'm looking at this like, wow, this really is trying to speak to the conservative out there, and remind me again, what about conservatives do they conserve? But anyways, as far as environment, these kinds of things. But this conservation pledge I wanted to read to you. I give my pledge as an American to save and faithfully to defend from waste the natural resources of my country. It's air, soil, and minerals. It's forests, waters, and wildlife. Yeah, you don't hear too much of stuff like that anymore, do you? Back to the coal jazz. Lots going on. Lots of information to share. The time has flown by tonight, and we're not going to be able to get to everything that I wanted to get to. Visit our Facebook page. It's all there on the Facebook page, facebook.com/filterfreeradio. Check it out. Good stuff. All the videos that we've played, everything that we've talked about, everything that we haven't talked about is there for you to check out. Please just spread the word to anyone you know in Oregon, Washington, the Pacific Northwest. I was just speaking with a friend who's watching the show on the break, and he's like, why ain't you talking about Idaho? And the rail lines that come through Idaho, there are some Indian reservations and some fishing areas and fishing habitat going on there. I mean, do the Native Americans in that area know? I doubt it, being one of the most kind of suppressed people, uninformed, these kinds of things.
Oppressed. The word you're looking for is oppressed.
Yes, oppressed. I'm sorry. Did I say suppressed? Yeah. I meant oppressed.
Well,
thank
that
you.
Too. But, I mean, they don't have any say in this anyway, so why would they? The sad thing about all this, too, is that you know about this because it's coming through your backyard. How many people don't know about this in your backyard? And moreover, how many people between where you are and these awful strip mining pits in Wyoming don't know about this going right by their neighborhoods as well?
Bingo.
It's just remarkable. I mean, how many communities will actually be affected? You know, that little video you showed where the train actually makes a U-shape across the state of Washington, across Wyoming and Montana. And it's going to affect a lot of people. And, of course, the path of least resistance because of the Cascade Mountains, as you have explained to me, Jacob.
Yes.
Is follow the rivers. So, yes. I mean, it's going to be polluting the water. It's just remarkable.
Yes, basically, the entire, as far as it coming to Oregon and Washington, the entire coal shipments will be going up the Willamette River. The Columbia River. Pardon me, the Columbia River. Damn it, Scott. The Columbia River. this is the kind of if you're not familiar with the Pacific Northwest, this is kind of the Columbia River Gorge. The Columbia Gorge is really like our jewel. It's this pristine amazing.
It's your Grand Canyon, is that what you're trying to say?
You betcha. And it is just amazing. And you know, it's important.
We don't need no stinking natural beauty. Right. We need fuel.
Right. Here, I'll show a couple of pictures of Portland area. This is a picture of the Port of Portland, the Port of Portland terminal, some of the terminals there. You see, this is the Columbia River and Mount Hood in the distance. These barges and stuff are going to be coming up the Columbia River, and the Columbia River separates the states of Oregon and Washington and eventually flows into the Pacific Ocean, where, of course, the coal will be exported to China, India, overseas, etc. This is not a good thing. This is an overhead picture of that. You see the Columbia River there. I-5 bridge, the demonstration on Saturday is going to be off of the Lombard exit off of I-5 in North Portland. You can check out goodgrowthnw.org for more information on the protests this Saturday. And I've got another shot here I want to show you of kind of the Port of Portland. This is the port that Jdfishn and I were talking about earlier in the program, where the Port of Portland 30 years ago in the 80s built a terminal for coal exporting out of the Port of Portland. And you can see the article headline from the Oregonian at the time, coal's once bright future goes up in smoke. It didn't happen. They converted this facility, purposefully built for coal, they converted it into a potash fertilizer exporting facility, and there's no coal because it didn't happen 30 years ago.
And why didn't it happen?
It didn't happen at the time because there was not an enough demand overseas for the exporting and the outlooks at the time. And there was a little bit of environmental opposition from the people, but mainly because of the lack of demand. Now, today, the scenario should be the exact opposite, where we have so much demand for coal that they are going to propose to do this, and we have to demand to stop it as, you know, informed and aware and really concerned citizens. Citizens of, you know, the
Earth.
As Herman Cain would say, citizens of Earth. You know, it's and you know, really back to what can you do? Call Oregon Governor John Kitzhaber. Write him. He's doing a great job. He really is. He's demanding further investigation and reports on these proposals. Some of the folks out there who are doing good work, Jim McDermott, representative up in Washington, Oregon Senator Jeff Merkley, they're trying to do the best they can as far as corporate-owned politicians can. You know, everyone's hands are tied, whether you want to admit it or not. It's the truth. I just went and saw the campaign with Will Ferrell and Zach Galifianakis last night.
Oh, I want to see that.
Funny movie.
Killing me.
Definitely worth watching. It's a good couple of good laughs in it. It was pretty good. Check it out. And no spoiler alert here, but the end of the movie really ties into exactly what I'm talking about right now. If you go see the movie, you'd be like, holy crap, wow. It does. But
a little close to home there, huh?
Yeah, and I'll just say it has to do with the Koch brothers and not outsourcing, but insourcing. So anyways, I won't give away any more of the movie than that, but what people need to be doing is just sharing the information, because you right now are being informed here. And when you take that information, that power, knowledge is power, and you contain it yourself, it's really kind of a selfish act in some ways. And this is about the common good for all of us. So all of us need to know these things. This just is a matter as simple as that. I'm rambling here. I want to mention I have phone numbers for people and things to contact in Oregon. Maybe I'll mention these in a sausage. Actually, no, I want to mention these really quick. Contact Greenpeace, because that's important as well. The North Portland Coal Committee, anyone in elected official office positions in Oregon, in Portland, Portland City Commissioners, representatives, senators, contact them. ColumbiaRiverKeeper.com is a great website for this issue specifically. ColumbiaRiverKeeper.com, GoodGrowthNW.org, PowerPastCoal.org as well. Strategies and tactics are being planned right now all throughout the Pacific Northwest. Saturday in Portland, there is a no-coal demonstration. Get there. FilterFreeRadio.com for more information. It's on the front page. We need your support and participation for success to protect our land and future. We got to pay attention here. I know a lot of folks are out there and a lot of folks are hurting and a lot of folks are really poor, but we can't be too poor to pay attention here.
I don't think it's any coincidence either that this is being pushed through at this time and juncture of where we are in our economy and society. I mean, it's obviously the economy is so damn poor here that they need to export coal. Secondly, it wouldn't get even a consideration, I think, let's say 10 years ago. Well, 10 years ago was still George Bush. Okay, 12 years ago?
Yep.
It'd be just an outrageous proposal because, hey, we don't need this crap. Why are we going to export coal? There's no benefit to the American populace for this. This is literally going to be, the definition of a third world country is a country that exports raw materials and imports finished goods. That is what we do now as a country. We're exporting fossil fuels and raw materials to China and India and all these other countries, and then we're importing the finished goods from them. I mean, we are literally a third world country. It's pathetic, and it astounds me that this is even being proposed at this point because, I mean, literally, damn well 10 years ago, 15 years ago, or whatever it is, this wouldn't have gotten through. I mean, there had been so much outrage and the reality of how unnecessary this is and how greedy this is on the behalf of. By the way, I think I learned from that video that in the articles you sent me that this is being pushed. Goldman Sachs is also behind this. Am I right about that?
Yes, they're funding it.
Yeah, there's Goldman Sachs and there's another big bank from Great Britain, and it's not Barclays. It's another one. I don't know. I want to say UBS, but that could be wrong. That's funding this.
Yeah.
These two major banking institutions have invested in this. This is a profit-making entity for them, and so they want to see their investment come to fruition so they can make their money back. And the bottom line is, it's about making money. Not about providing people energy and fuel, and it's about making money. That's the bottom line.
And don't kid yourself. Everything that we're talking about is on our Facebook page. There was a report that came out released by the title of the group, the Alliance for Northwest Jobs and Exports. What it really is was a coalition of coal and barge and railroad companies and the chambers of commerce groups, a coalition of these people, and they put out this report, headline, Northwest Coal Terminals Will Add $6 Billion to the Economy. Right. And you read the, statement and from the statement, quote, this report confirms what we already know in the Northwest. We can continue to build our strong trade heritage, creating thousands of new jobs and millions in new tax revenue for our region and do it in an environmentally responsible way. End quote. What? No! Wrong!
I mean, what a lie that is. Jeez.
Bad! Blatant bull crap lies. I posted that. If you'd like to read it, it's on the Facebook page. There are other reports from WashingtonPorts.org. WashingtonPorts.org. The Columbia River transport proposal will likely threaten and harm fish habitat. Yeah. Also, part in the category of what can we do, the Army Corps of Engineers plays a role in the decision process of these coal terminal proposals. The Portland Business Journal wrote an article on this. It is published. I don't have too much time to talk about it, but but it's on our Facebook page as well. There are several local conservation groups that are calling for reports for expanded review of these coal terminals. The projected devastating effects environmentally of these proposals. How come, you know, it's like when proposals like this are just pushed and rammed through so fast and so, you know, backdoor sneak behind the curtain, pay no attention to that man behind the curtain. It's like, why is all of this in darkness? Oh, maybe because the deeds that they are performing are evil. we posted from the website Chamity.
Because if it wasn't, they'd be bragging about it, dude.
Exactly. From Chamity.org, coal power, the dirtiest form of energy. That article is on our Facebook page. And I even went as far as to link to a Wikipedia page. You can Wikipedia the environmental impacts of the coal industry. It's on Wikipedia, for God's sakes.
I mean, it hasn't been scrubbed yet. You know, it's funny. I accidentally just entered the coalfacts.org, and I got I got a propaganda website for coal. It's actually the one one I was thinking of was coaltrainfacts.org.
Careful.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. I'm looking at this coalfacts, going, oh, these are good graphics, and of course, it's propaganda. But the coaltrainfacts.org, I think, is an interesting site. It's on our Facebook page, and it's got just some neat pictures, but it's got just a lot of information. And yeah, Goldman Sachs, as it turns out, is is one of the ones bankrolling this. So it's just amazing. Yeah, that's how they invest their money.
Yeah. The only other things I want to mention, we've only got a few minutes left to wrap up the show. Again, if you're in the Portland area, calling all Oregonians, Washingtonians, people in the Columbia River Gorge, anyone who can get to Portland this Saturday. We are holding, or I should say rather, the North Portland Coal Committee, a nonprofit, independent, grassroots activism group, is holding a no coal demonstration in Portland this Saturday, noon to 3 p.m. It's at the St. John's Railroad Cut at North Lombard in North Portland. It's off I-5. Take Lombard west off I-5, 2 miles to the Fred Meyers on Lombard and Ida. That's where we will be. I will be there this Saturday at noon to 3. I'll have a little video camera, and we'll do a little audio interviews, and I'll be out there, you know, participating in grassroots activism. So I hope to see you there if you can make it. I want to plug that again. For more information, Bonnie Meltzer's website is brilliantly laid out at goodgrowthnw.org, goodgrowthnw.org, and also their Facebook page, and I'll put up the graphic of Bonnie there, facebook.com/North Portland Coal Committee for other great information on this. You know, that's really, you know... And there's a couple other things I want to mention also on filterfreeradio.com. I wrote a blog over the week, and big thanks to Ray Medeiros of USA Progressive and Bob and Rain over at Four Freedoms blog, who republished the article. And thanks to Will from Chicago in the chat room, who sent the article around. I wrote a kind of lengthy article on morality, talking in the title of the article.
1,500 words.
The article was titled... have we surpassed the threshold of salvation? And it kind of got into religion a little bit, but I want to mention that it's not a religious-based article. The point is morality. And even if you're not religious or into religion, even if you can still care about the environment, you can still do good, you can still have morals and ethics and not be religious. But those who call themselves religious and don't practice morals and ethics, I tried to call those people out and reach out to them and say, hey, what's going on here? So I wrote a blog about morality. You can check that out on our website, filterfreeradio.com. Scott, any kind of final thought wrapping up things you want to mention or talk about? Is there anything that we missed that you want to mention? Or when you emailed me earlier about the Hillcrest mine disaster, that was kind of interesting to talk about if you want. Or we've only got a couple minutes left, so you know it might not be a good thing to dive into that. But you know.
That's the coolest fucking story I've ever heard in my entire life. That's insane. Can I hear it again? Do you have time?
Oh, goodness.
Yeah, dude. Well, that's just the thing that struck me was, you know, I found that one song last night, and it led me to the hill, whatever that hill was called. There's just so much history behind industry in societies, and I mean globally, not just the U.S., but certainly in the U.S. as well, and North America in particular. There's just a history of labor abuse, environmental abuse. I mean, it really all comes down to greed, you know. And if you're going to exploit the land, you're going to exploit the people to get the stuff out of the land so you can make this money. You're inherently doing evil, and I don't use that word lightly. I'm talking about. I mean, these people themselves are just working for such and such institutions. But the point is that these institutions are systems of death. I mean, this coal is going to kill people one way or the other. If, you know, whether it be in Wyoming or you know, in China or whatever, you know, it's indirectly and directly going to kill people, that's something we shouldn't take lightly. It's worth mentioning, and I know that sounds, you know, maybe bombastic even, but it really is. It really comes down, even in the long run, this is killing the environment, which is going to kill all of us. And so you have to, you know, religion be damned. You have to think of things in moral terms. In empathy terms, and saying, you know, do I want to leave a better world for the next generation, or fuck it, we're going to die anyway, so let's burn it down, you know, and get the most out of it I can before I die. And I think a lot of these people in industry, captains of industry, titans of industry, if you will, are very cynical individuals. They know that shit is fucked up, and they're going to get theirs before it all goes down, and that's how they feel about it, because it's just the system in which they work, and they have the capacity to do these things. And it's just really, there's got to be a way to stop this. And I struggle every day with what is the higher issue? What's the largest issue? You know, macro issues.
Sure.
And I think being able to live on a sustainable planet is probably the number one issue, because we can talk about democracy and economies all you want, but if we're dead, there is no planet. There is no democracy. There's no, you know, so...
Hallelujah. No, I want to mention, nothing against gay rights, nothing against the legalization of marijuana, nothing against, you know, these, you know, issues which are important
and people are,
you know, working on. That's great. But I'm totally with you, Scott. If we don't have like a planet in which that can support our lives, everything else is irrelevant. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, it is. And the more you think about it, the more you put all these pieces together, the more you realize that the Keystone XL pipeline, the coal train, the nuclear reactors leaking all this freaking stuff. I mean, we're going to kill ourselves just so we can have electricity.
Right.
You know, it's like, how important is electricity really when we're going to die?
Right.
You know, and that's the great, and the technology that comes with that, you know, the notion that everything revolves around computers these days and da 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 da. And it's like, well, you know, all this isn't going to be here if we don't have electricity, and we're not going to have electricity at this rate. Unless we continue to exploit the natural resources that give us this electricity, at which point it's going to kill us. And it's really one big vicious cycle. So we have to break the cycle. And that's really the bottom line of just breaking the cycle. And how we do that, you know, there's numerous ways, and I don't have any answers, but I think it needs to be established that this has to end. And we have to start doing something about it in some capacity, whether it's on Facebook, whether it's actually laying in the street to stop the train or whatever.
Right.
And there are protests where people will lay on the tracks and stop the train, you know, whatever it comes down to.
You know, I thought of mine passed while I was prepping all this material for the show about if the proposal passes and they begin to construct these things and they build that one path right through that one, you know, new... proposed coal train route through my backyard, might have to walk around door to door and get some folks to go lay down in front of the track. You know, I don't know. I want to mention real quick again, Chris Hedges' most recent book is called Days of Destruction, Days of Revolt. It is literally exactly what we are talking about. He went around to the coal, the devastated coal areas, West Virginia, etc., and
it's a graphic novel with Joe Sacco. And he went to the Immokalee, Florida, the tomato pickers. He went to West Virginia, where this town's been completely cold out. He went to what was the other one? It's in It's the Indian reservation up there where they're just destitute poverty and alcoholism. And the life expectancy is 48 years.
Yeah.
And then, of course, one other place that I'm drawing a blank on. Oh, New Jersey. Camden, New Jersey. God, how could I forget?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so and just what is now known in the term is post-industrial pockets.
Yep. And we are out of time for the show. So, you know, just to wrap up, I want to say, you know, big thanks to Bonnie Meltzer, the co-founder of North Portland Coal Committee, for coming on. Also, Jdfishn, my dad, for coming on and sharing about the port. Scott, you brother, for being here every week, man. You know, it's great. It's awesome. And to have a such a great co-host and smart guy to talk the truth with is fun, and I appreciate it.
Aww.
So also big thanks to Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com, DJ Downtown at progressiveblendradio.com, everyone in the chat room, everyone who watches on YouTube and on our website, filterfreeradio.com. The other Radio or Not evening shows, Kenny Pick, Turn Up the Night, Tom, Deba, Shane, Danielle, Talking Left. Love you guys. Check out Nurse Talk Thursday nights. Also, big thanks to Dano, danosongs.com, and the Roy Burt at crownedrecords.com for music production. Check out Filter Free Radio on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and our website, filterfreeradio.com. We'll see you next week, next Monday. Get out there and stop the coal trains.
In Jesus' name, boogity, 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 amen.
This is it.
There's a time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part. You can't even passively take part. And you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop.
Listening to Jacob Dean, streaming live on the web.
The revolution will be broadcast.
We bring you the real stuff.